بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفر
الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك والعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما ثنيت على نفسك فلك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إذا رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في كل وقت وحين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد حتى ترك الأرض ومن عليها أنت خير وارثين نويت تعلم وتعليم وتذكر وتذكير النفع انتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على تمسك بكتاب الله بسنة الرسول صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم ودعاء إلى الهدى ودلالة على الخير ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى
آمين
Okay, inshallah ta'ala, I'll read through the slides. I don't think we have the projector this week, inshallah ta'ala. So where we were right at in terms of the thematic look of this, at the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it now relates to prophecy in and of itself. Prophecy that is called Nubuwah, which is obviously the ultimate purpose of the manifestation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam upon earth. And we've looked at various elements which are essential for us to gather some type of knowledge regarding them in order to create a context by which we can understand the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the great mission that was entrusted to him by Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay, so we're looking now at prophecy, and there are going to be two elements, really important elements, that relate to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One is Nubuwa, which is prophecy, and the second one is Risala, which is messengership. And they're both going to have two different and somewhat distinct connotations. And what we're looking at, what I titled this, was called Prophecy from Knowledge to Experience. From Knowledge to Experience. Because many people fail to grasp the difference in regards to the Prophet ﷺ, he himself, yani between, yani when does he become a prophet in the what, in the physical sense, in this world? When? Okay? When? And we see the hadith in multiple narrations which relate to the fact that the prophecy of the Prophet ﷺ was somewhat ancient. His prophecy was ancient. And his knowledge of that prophecy was also ancient also. I don't think it was some type of abstract knowledge that the Prophet ﷺ was not made privy to later. Because when he's asked ﷺ, Meta kunta nabiyya, when were you a prophet? That's a very, very clear question. And the answer also is very clear. That comes from the Messenger ﷺ. Although we have varying narrations with regards to his answer. When he says ﷺ, Kuntu nabiyyan wa adam munjadilan bitinatihi. Wa kuntu nabiyyan wa adam bayna ruhi wal jasad. وَكُنْتُ نَبِيًّا وَآدَمْ بَيْنَ الْمَاءِ وَطِينَ There are different rewires, the answers of the messenger. I was a prophet whilst Adam was still being intermingled into his physical form. I was a prophet whilst Adam was between water and clay. I was a prophet when Adam was between body and soul. The Prophet ﷺ said, that's ancient. Because here, the Prophet ﷺ is speaking about his prophecy prior to Adam being Adam, alayhi salam. Okay? Stages. Because whether we speak about Adam between water and clay, water and earth, that is the first stage. Whether we speak about Adam being between soul and body, that's stage number two. And when we speak about Adam, munjadilan bitinatihi, that is the final stage in the formation of Sayyidina Adam, alayhi salam. Either the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is speaking about his prophecy, yani from the beginning to the end of the word of crafting by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the great prophet and primordial man, Sayyidina Adam, alayhi salam. That knowledge that he had, and that knowledge that he descends into this world. And we see another riwayah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks about his knowledge, about when he's in the loins of Sayyidina Adam, when Adam makes the hubut, the descent from paradise to earth. He had knowledge of that, he was well aware. He said, I had knowledge of the time when Sayyidina Nuh was upon the safina, upon the great ark. Knowledge of it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also spoke about his knowledge of when Sayyidina Ibrahim ulqiya fi nar. Because he's in the loins of Sayyidina Ibrahim, he's in the loins of Sayyidina Nuh, and he's likewise in the loins of Sayyidina Adam. So he was aware, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Likewise, he's aware of his prophecy from the first primordial moment. But what faces us at the 40th year of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not him coming into knowledge of the fact that he's a prophet, but it's prophetic experience. Something radically different. See, we may know something, and we may know something in detail, but knowledge is not experience. They can be radically, and they are in fact radically different. And that is what we're speaking of with regards to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his 40th birthday, from knowledge to experience. We see the hadith which is related by Imam Ahmad radiallahu ta'ala on the authority of Abdullah ibn Abbas, with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I was in Mecca for 15 years. For 7 years he would see light and hear voices, and for 8 years revelation descended upon him. He lived in Medina for 10 years. Okay, this is the hadith of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas. And obviously Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, because where's the problem with the hadith? The problem with the hadith is Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas saying that the Prophet was in Mecca for 15 years. We know he was in Medina for 10 years. And ordinarily the Sahaba, especially the younger Sahaba, you can see a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari where Sayyidina Anas speaks about the Prophet being in Mecca 10 sinin, وَبِالْ مَدِينَ لِعَشَرِ سِنِينَ وَتُوَفَّاهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى رَأْسِ 60 سَنَةً. And he was in Mecca for 10 years, Medina for 10 years, and Allah took his life when he was 60 years of age on his 60th birthday. That's a hadith of Anas. But Anas is from the younger Sahaba, radiallahu ta'ala anha. Sahaba, مَا ذَاكَ مَكَّةً. He did not taste Mecca, did not experience Mecca. He's Medini, he saves the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam virtually from the day he enters into Medina to the day he dies, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Anas, he says about himself that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Medina, أَضَاءَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ وَعِنْدَمَا تُوُفِّيَ أَظْلَمَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. That when he entered Medina, everything became illumined. And when he died, everything was darkened once again, Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala an said. So here Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas also, there's something in his words. Because Abdullah ibn Abbas is that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dies, Abdullah ibn Abbas is a ghulam. A ghulam. And a ghulam in the Arabic language means he's between 7 and 10 years of age. The great Sahabi Abdullah ibn Abbas. So therefore he's also one of those مَذَاكَ مَكَّةَ, that he never what tasted or experienced Mekkatul Mukarramah radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So that's why we're going to see that a lot of the ahadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik, of Sayyidina Abu Huraira, those Sahaba who experienced the Prophet in Medina, they're going to take at the feet of other Sahaba, the old ones, Al-Awwalun, the Sabiqun, Min Al-Muhajirin Wal-Ansar, the early ones who tasted Mecca, even if they were from Medina. Because you know many of the Medinis, the early Medinis, that they tasted Mecca for approximately 3 years. Okay, so what does he say? 15 years. He was in Mecca for 15 years. So is it right or wrong? I mean, what's the opinion? 13. The opinion is that the Prophet is in Mecca for 13 years. So is Abdullah ibn Abbas, is he yani rounding it off? And that's what they say with Anas ibn Malik. How did they get out of Anas's 10 years? They say yani it's tariq al-adad, that he's just rounding it off, making it a round number. That's how the Mufassirun yani interpreted saying Anas's quote-unquote apparent contradiction to the fact of Mecca. What about Abdullah ibn Abbas? We say no. Why? Because Abdullah ibn Abbas is the great Habr al-Ummah. He is the great erudite scholar of this nation. And he's not going to speak in generic terms, Abdullah ibn Abbas. This really differs from Sayyidina Anas. So Abdullah ibn Abbas is one of the fuqaha of the Sahaba. He's one of the what we would call the Sahaba who has his own madhab. That's what it meant. A Sahaba and Tabi'in would follow the madhab of Abdullah ibn Abbas amongst the other madhahib or amongst the Sahaba. Great, the Prophet ﷺ prayed for Abdullah ibn Abbas. Allahumma faqihhu fi al-deen wa alimhu ta'wil. Dua of the Messenger ﷺ, Abdullah ibn Abbas. Oh Allah, give him understanding of the religion and teach him subtle, detailed interpretation of revelation. That's the dua of the Messenger. So Abdullah ibn Abbas, when he says 15, there's a secret behind the number 15. And what he is speaking about are the stages of experience that the Prophet ﷺ is going to go through in the formative period of Mecca. Because as we know, we're going to see in the hadith of Sayyidina Aisha in Sahih al-Bukhari, that the Prophet ﷺ, when he was 38 years of age, حُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ الْخَلْوَى, that was becoming a recluse, removing himself from society, was made dear to him, was made beloved to him. 38 years of age. So these 2 years are critical, because you add 13 to 2, you've got the 15 years that Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas is what is speaking about as the Meccan period of the Prophet ﷺ. This is Mecca. So Mecca does not begin at Nubuwa, but it begins prior to Nubuwa, because that is going to be, in a sense, our portion of how do we apprehend the reality of prophecy, i.e. what does that mean? You see, when we say Ashhad an la ilaha illallah, wa Ashhad anna Muhammad Rasulullah, you see, what does that mean? You see, Ashhad, I bear witness, I testify. In the ulama of Tawheed or theology, they tell us that it is incorrect, impermissible for anybody to change the term Ashhad, to bear witness, to see, to experience with your senses. That's what they say. And if you used a word which is a synonym, u'lin, a'taqid, u'min, I believe, I declare, I have a firm belief in, then your shahada is null and void. It's not sound. The only word you can use is ashhad. That's the only word you can use. And ashhad is a term that clearly alludes not to a belief in divinity, in tawheed, in monotheism, in oneness, Unitarian faith, not to a belief in the fact that the Prophet Muhammad is Rasulullah, is a messenger of Allah, but it alludes to an experience of divinity and an experience of prophecy. And that is why with the Prophet on the hadith of Abdullah bin Abbas and Ahmed, that these 2 years is about for us, how do we experience the reality of prophecy? That's what it's about. Because when he's a prophet, he says, there's no prophet after me. So we get no portion of him being a prophet. We get no portion of him being a Rasul in that sense. What do we get a portion of? Those 2 years prior, which is what they call the Taraqqi fi darajat al-wilaya. This is the ascension in the ranks of sainthood, of protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has called wilaya, to the point that at Nubuwa, ashhad. You now have the ahliya, the due qualification, to experience the reality of who he is as a prophet. That is really critical to our understanding of religion, because what's the difference between this generation and the generation of the Sahaba? The difference is experience. That's it. It's not knowledge. In fact, we could say that knowledge, outward knowledge, we have vastly more knowledge than the Sahaba themselves. So why then are we different from them? Why is this type of when the Prophet spoke about realities that maybe we face in this day and age, realities where the Muslims are humiliated, with, you know, in all this nonsense where they see we're not targeting Muslims, you see we're targeting the extremists from amongst the Muslims, that's a blatant lie. Right now it's about, like yesterday the faqir, I came from Andalus, from Spain, we entered from train from France, and we entered the St. Pancras station. Immediately we were taken, we were detained under the terrorist law, terrorists, and then we had our DNA taken, our fingerprints taken, for what? You see, we've got to ask the question, for what? You see, that's the age the Prophet ﷺ spoke about, where he says, "Tatada'a alaykum al-umam," that the nations of the world will play with you, they will all descend upon you and ravage you. كَمَا تَتَدَاعَ الْأَكَلَةُ عَلَى قَصْوَتِهَا. In the same way you see hungry diners can descend and ravage a great meal. Same way. What do the Sahaba say? أَمِنْ قِلَّتِنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Because we're few in numbers. I mean, did they try to figure out how could that be? How could the nations of the world descend upon the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ? Be nusiru. When he says ﷺ, through me, victory is granted. Not through knowledge of the Prophet ﷺ, but through experience of the prophetic reality. That's the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. And that's why it's on the basis of that experience. You see, when you see that the likes of Sayyidina Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl, you know Ikrimah is? Ikrimah is the son of Abu Jahl. And Ikrimah becomes one of the great leaders, generals of this ummah. You see, many of us who are from India or from Pakistan, we have to give thanks to Sayyidina Ikrimah, because it was the armies, the leadership of Ikrimah, that began to open up the lands, min wara al-nahar, that go to the east of the Arabian Peninsula. That's Ikrimah. What was the secret of Ikrimah inside of war? The same secret that Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid had inside a wall, which was what? Wa Muhammada. Wa Muhammada. What does Wa Muhammada mean? That's what they would call in war. Wa Muhammada is calling out what they call al-istighatha. You are calling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for experiential help, experiential assistance, experiential victory. That's what you're calling out for. You see, it's not knowledge. Because we can say, wa Muhammada. Mafi. Nothing takes place. You see, because it's not here, adrati assanation, it's not intellect. This is the experience of the soul of the Muhammadan reality. And when we speak about saying Ikrimah Abi Jahl, for how long was Ikrimah Muslim? You see, this is the secret. Ikrimah, two years approximately, he's Muslim until the Prophet dies. 2 years. Yet the experience of the Muhammadan reality within inside them 2 years could render him great and could render the so-called of the Prophet great also for him in his stead. Same with Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid, their attachment. Sayyidina Khalid in the great war when he nearly gets killed. He's running inside of the Sufuf like a madman, Majaneen. He's like mad, Sayyidina Khalid. That's why Sayyidina Hassan al-Basri, what did he say? Ra'aytu unasan. I saw people, la ra'aytahum, la hasibatu majaneen. If you'd seen them, you'd consider them madmen. That's what Hassan al-Basri, the great tabi'i, said. That's a sahaba. So we see Khalid acting like a madman on the battlefield. And when they see him come to, they ask, what was all that about? He said, a hair of the messenger of Allah that he kept inside of his helmet, Khalid ibn Walid. And when his helmet fell with the head of the Prophet you see, he lost it. It's like what you call panic. When you go into a panic attack, you begin to focus upon your maqsood, focus upon the objective, lose his sense of everything else, and all he can see is the helmet, and he can't see the sword swinging. But why is he protected? Wa Muhammad. Because of his experiential relationship with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The point being, these 2 years, before the Prophet engages Gabriel, are really important years. Because the Prophet is showing us how do we experience prophecy. That's what he's showing us. And that experience, the science of that experience, you're going to find with Ahlul Qulub, the people of hearts, the people of spirituality. They're the ones who've understood them 2 years in detail, and they're the ones who've laid out for us a very detailed path, way, curriculum for becoming people of experience of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So that's what's important about that. The four stages. We had a slide of it which looks at the four stages. Four stages. What are the four stages of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam we're going to see? First one is called Hanif. It's called Hanafiyya. A Hanif, the stage of Hanif. We'll explain the words. So he was writing on Hanif is the first. Or do we have a pen here? No. The second is wilaya. Wilaya. Stage number two, wilaya, which is also what we were alluding to before. The third is prophecy, which is nubuwa. And the fourth is risala, which is messengership. So we have hanafiyya, and bu'ithtu bi hanafiyya to samha. The Prophet said, I've been sent with the way of the hanifs and the clement way. The way of forgiveness and mercy and beauty. That's what he said. Sa'id in the hadith of Sahih. So the first is the Hanafiyya. The second is Wilaya. The third is Nubuwa. And the fourth is the Risala. Okay. What is Hanafiyya? The word Hanif in the Arabic language is a very, very interesting term. Because it tells us just as much about the person as it does about the society in which the person has been sent or raised. Because the word Hanafiyya, it more so refers, or maybe the best way we could translate it, as a socio-religious deviant. That's what the word Hanif means. Like Allah Ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلَصِينَ لَحُدِينَ حُنَفَى. That's the way they're Hunafa. We've been commanded to be Hunafa, commanded to be Hanifs. And the Prophet ﷺ is going to be a Hanif in the formative period prior to 38 years of age. He's a Hanif. That's how he walks Mecca. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what's a Hanif? Socio-religious, deviant. Why deviant? Because it tells us about the norm of a society. Who was the great Hanif? Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam was the great Hanifan, Musliman. Wa ma ana min al-mushrikeen. Wa ma kana min al-mushrikeen. Ibrahim in the Quran, He's a Hanif, he's a Muslim, and he's the one who called us Muslims, Ibrahim the great prophet, in the loft of the Quran. And he's a Hanif, wa ma kana min al-mushrikeen. He's one of those who associate what partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ was also a Hanif, because he was somebody who was new, first and foremost, they knew the dominant way of Mecca was idolatry. One of the tribe of Khuza'a, one of the great leaders of Khuza'a in the formative period of what they call Jahiliyyah al-Ula, the first Jahiliyyah, the epochs of Jahiliyyah, according to the Hadith of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, the first epoch of Jahiliyyah, that's over 500 years prior to the Prophet ﷺ's coming, that what the great imam from this great leader from Khuza'a, he's the one who brings what? It's called Amr al-Khuza'i. He's the one who brings what? Idolatry into Mecca. He's the one who brings Hubal. He's the one who brings Manat, Al-Uzza. You see, Al-Lat. He brings all of the gods that the Quraysh and the people of Ta'if are going to worship. The first one, and that's his sunnah, min stanna sunnat al-hasana, min stanna sunnat al-sayya, the one who introduces a good sunnah and a bad sunnah, khalas. They're the predecessors, they're the salaf. And we have good salaf, but you can also have bad salaf. So Mecca becomes a place of idolatry. And people come to Mecca, not as the place of tawheed, the divinity of Allah Ta'ala, unity of Allah Jalla fil Ula, but as a place where Allah Ta'ala is associated with in terms of worship and Godhood. That's why they come to Mecca. But here we see the Prophet Sallallahu Wasallam, who's known in Mecca, and he's not of those who worship the idols of the Quraysh. Just like, as we made mention of before, his father wasn't, or his uncles, a lot of his uncles weren't, or his grandfather Abdul Muttalib clearly wasn't a person of what? A person who worshipped the idols. You see, well, the Prophet ﷺ comes forth and he's radically different from his own household, the Ahlul Bayt, those Hashimis, those who come from the loins of Hashim, as Abdul Muttalib and others did. And later, anybody who reads Seerah with a superficial understanding of Seerah can only come to that conclusion. Never mind if you go into the great books of the people of the prophetic biography. Okay? So he's a Hanif. And he hangs out with Hunafa. Who are his friends? So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Abu Bakr ever known to worship idols? Abada. Okay? Abu Bakr is a close friend of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Khadija al-Kubra. Khadija ever known to worship idols? La wallahi. La yukhziyak Allah. The first word she says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he tells her about the experience of Gabriel, and he said, what is taking place? What is happening? The move from knowledge to experience? She says, kalla. Yani, this has to be real. Allah could never humiliate you. Why not Hubal? Is this the first encounter? Why is she speaking of Allah Ta'ala? Khadija, abadan. You see, the likes of Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal, who's considered the greatest of what are literally called the Hunafa, the friend of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in Jahiliyyah, knows the hangs with Zayd bin Nawfal. They go on trips together, they sit, and when people bring meat slaughtered in the name of idols, Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal says, I do not eat anything that is what? Slaughtered in other than the name of Allah Ta'ala, and not an idolater, take it away from me. So they would take the food to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam secondly, and the Prophet would say the same thing, I don't eat the food that has been slaughtered in other than the name of Allah Ta'ala. Hunafa, Zayd bin Amr, the most noble and the most important of all of them. That's why Imam al-Bukhari, Muhammad Ismail al-Bukhari, he has an entire chapter in Sahih al-Bukhari, which is the chapter of Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal. Somebody who dies in Jahiliyyah, you see, he doesn't what meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a prophet, but he meets the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a Hanif. That's what he meets the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as. And when he hears that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has declared prophecy, he's in a place called Busra, which is in southern Jordan. When he hears that the Prophet has declared prophecy, he immediately leaves for Mecca. They say Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Sahibukum, your friend, yani khalas, he's declared he's the final prophet. He leaves immediately for Mecca to believe in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he's assassinated on the way, killed on the way. One of the last people who were with him, he told that individual, when you meet the Prophet at the end of time, akri alayhi salam, give him my salams. So when this great Sahaba meets the Prophet and believes in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal, akra alayka salam. He conveyed his salams to you. And the Prophet ﷺ said, wa alayka salam, ya Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal. Great individual who's in paradise with the shahada of the Prophet ﷺ. So the Hunafa are socio-religious deviants. They don't take to society. You see, in fact, they stand against society. And that's amazing because we have terms that are like that in Arabic. Like, what's another term which alludes to deviance? adl, justice. It's amazing that the very word, which is the name of Allah Ta'ala, and it's the name for justice in the Arabic language, it means deviancy. You see, it means some type of opposition to a norm. And it's telling you that the nature of the world is that it's what? Unjust. And those who stand up for just, bi ismihi al-adl, in the name of Allah Ta'ala, the just are going to be by nature deviants. And the Muslims are deviants by their nature. That's why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, for every 199 enter hell. That's ikhbar al-nabuwa. What's that telling you about the nature of civilizations, the nature of societies? Where 99% of people are on the fast track to hell by the testimony of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay, so here we had issues about, we had slides about the Hunafa. And he says they were a select number of monotheists to endeavor to practice the original teachings of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, especially in regards to uncompromising monotheistic theology and the impending appearance of the Prophet of the Last of Days. These are two things that characterize the Hunafa. The first is that they were monotheists, radical. That's why in Sahih al-Bukhari, Imam Bukhari brings the hadith of Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal, who goes and stands at the Kaaba, and he stands holding the kiswa at the Kaaba by the black stone, and he says, Ya ma'ashir al-Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, you, all your idolatry, none of yous worship Allah but me. You see, I'm the only one on this religion. Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal, hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. So they were radical in their monotheism. But Majaneen, why weren't they a threat? Just a few individuals who declared monotheism. You see, no great following, nobody following them. You see, no threat to the idols of Quraysh. Just more so a declaration they upon one God. Not a problem. But what's going to be important about these people, they begin to sow in the minds of the Quraysh the ideal, the primordial ideal and belief of monotheism. So that when the Prophet appears and declares it, it's not brand new. Because the human beings are saying, Ali ibn Abi Talib says, that we naturally reject that which is brand new. You see? So Allah Ta'ala is not going to allow that to be an excuse. Well, where did you get this from? What's monotheism? Our forefathers were not warned, were heedless of monotheism? No. When the coming of the Prophet Sallallahu, Allah brings forth individuals prior to him, and he's also going to be one of them on the latter point, who begin to speak about the ideal of monotheism without the context of prophecy. So that now the Quraysh, there's something familiar about what he's going to speak about later on. You see, that's like in the hadith of the ends of time, that's why the Prophet speaks about who are called the Mumahidun. You see, one of them called Saleh. Who are the Mumahidun? They are people at the end of time who come forth and they speak manhaj al-Nabuwa. They speak the way of prophecy, the original way of prophecy. Why do we call them the Mumahidun? Because they prepare for the Mahdi. So that when the Mahdi comes, the Prophet says, it's not brand new that there were people who prepared for the manifestation of the last real great person from this Ummah, from the Ummah, the exclusion of Sayyidina Isa ibn Maryam, and the Mahdi himself, he's got the same word, Mahdi. Why is he? Because Mahdi can mean what? To be guided. It can also mean to prepare. Yani Mumahid, like you say, Umahid al-Tariq. I prepare the path. That's Arabic language. The Mahdi prepares for whom? Jesus, the son of Mary, alayhi salam. That's one of the reasons why his name is also called Al-Mahdi, the one who prepares for what? The final coming of Christ, alayhi salam. Okay? So these were certain individuals that we're going to see inside of Mecca, and they're going to be very, very important. Who are some of the most prominent? Qus bin Sa'idah al-Ayyadi. Qus bin Sa'idah al-Ayyadi. Very important individual. A great poet. He's from Al-Bahrain, from the eastern provinces of Arabia. And he's somebody that the Prophet ﷺ had great respect for. A real great respect for. And some of the people of Arabic language say he is the only poet in history who in the chain of transmission of his poetry, you find the name Muhammad ibn Abdullah Rasulullah. That the only what poet who the Prophet says is in the chain of transmission of the poetry of Qus bin Sa'id al-Ayyadi. Great Imam. The famous hadith which is in the year of delegation, roughly the 8th year, after what? After Hijrah, when all the great delegations of the Arabs come to Medina to what? To believe in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or to pay homage to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Of the most famous of whom, it's called Wafd Abdul Qais. It's the delegation of Abdul Qais. Very, very famous delegation. long hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari that relates to them and the Sha'an, the affair of prophecy, Wafd Abdul Qais. When Wafd Abdul Qais come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one of the first things, where are you from? Where Wafd Abdul Qais bin Bahrain? He's from the eastern province of Arabia. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ta'arif Qus bin Sa'id al-Ayyadi. Do you know Qus bin Sa'id al-Ayyadi? They say, Na'am. He said, Mada hadatha bihi? What happened to him? And he said, Qad halak. And he's died. He's died. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Men minkum ya'arif shi'rahu. Who knows his poetry? They said, Kulluna na'arif. All of us know his poetry. And then the Prophet began to request that they begin to what? Recite the great poetry of Qus bin Sa'id al-Ayyadi. Famous, first individual. Okay, the second, because what's important about him, he's speaking monotheism, one, and he's speaking about the coming of the final Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's even more important about Qus bin Sa'id al-Ayyadi, how did the Prophet know him? He stood at Iqab. He stood at the great souk, the great festival in what, in the Hajj season, at Mecca, at Muna. He stood there and he recited poetry. And then he also began to speak about the coming of the final Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who's in the audience? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Both of them are sitting, listening to Qus bin Sa'id al-Ayyadi. That's in prior to his 40 years of age, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the receiving of prophecy. Very, very important individual. The Prophet paid great homage to. Another individual is someone called Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal. We spoke about him. Really great. And you see, he's great because of what he did, preparing the way for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why is he also great? Great man, produced great children. Great. He produces Sa'id ibn Zayd. Sa'id ibn Zayd, one of the 10 people who are guaranteed paradise from the great Sahaba. Sa'id ibn Zayd is the one who has the second great madrasa in Mecca. There are two great madrasas in Mecca, what's called Dar al-Arqam. Dar al-Arqam ibn al-Arqam al-Makhzumi, the place where the Prophet would teach with the Ashraf, with the nobles, the blue-blood aristocrats, Qurayshis. They were the only ones who had access to what Dar al-Arqam. Then he had a second madrasa, which is called Dar Sa'id, the House of Sa'id. Who used to be in there? All of the ones who never had great lineage. They were considered laity. All those who were not from Mecca. All those who did the menial jobs in Mecca. Prophet placed them in a very different madrasa, headed up by an individual, Khabbab ibn Arrat and Sa'id ibn Zayd. And also the sister of Sayyid Umar ibn Khattab, Fatima bint Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala anha. Great place. Who's Sa'id ibn Zayd? He's the son of Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal. You see, that's a great sign. And you see, the great Hunafa were like this. I mean, who's another great Hanif? His name is what? Is Zuhair bin Abi Sulma. Zuhair bin Abi Sulma. Zuhair bin Abi Sulma is the father of a great individual for us. His name is Ka'b ibn Zuhair. Ka'b ibn Zuhair is the one where he recites, Inna al-Rasul al-Sayfun yustada'u bihi muhallalan min suyuf Allahi maslulu. He recites the famous line of poetry, the 60-line poem. The Prophet ﷺ says, speak poetry. And he begins to recite a 60-line poem, yani, freestyle, as they would say in just a modern sort of language, freestyle, spontaneously 60-line poem. In the midst of it, he has a famous line, Inna Rasul, verily the messenger is a safe, is a sword, yustada'u bihi, that we seek light from, muhannadun. Muhannad means crafted in India, because they were the greatest swords in Arabia, those that were built or crafted in India. So he calls, he says, Muhannadun min suyufillahi maslul. That is from the swords of God unsheathed. And when the Prophet heard those words, the Prophet stood with his burda, his cloak, and he goes to Ka'b ibn Zuhair, and he wraps his cloak around Ka'b ibn Zuhair. That's why Imam al-Busayri, Al-Bayjuri, Ibrahim al-Bayjuri, Sheikh al-Ashar, in the 18th century, he says that we call Busayri the burda. Everyone knows the burda. Mawlaya sali wa salim da'im. Burda. That's Qasidat on the burda. Okay, it's called the burda. Imam al-Bujayri on his sharh of this, he says you shouldn't call it the burda, because the burda is Ka'b ibn Zuhair. Because he got the burda of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that burda was then taken by Muawiyah. Muawiyah paid tens of thousands of gold coins to take the burda of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that was passed in the lineage of Banu Umayyah. That anytime the Khalifa of Banu Umayyah, 91 years of Banu Umayyah, would stand on the minbar, they would wear the burda of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that was originally given to Ka'b ibn Zuhair radiallahu ta'ala an. But what's the secret of Ka'b? His father, Zuhair ibn Abi Sulma, monotheist. That's why if you read his poetry, because he's considered one of the seven greatest poets of all time. He's been Ashab al-Mu'allaqat, from the seven whose poetry was written in gold ink and hung on the Kaaba, because it was so great, spontaneous poetry. And when you read his poetry, it's all about monotheism and akhlaq. It differs from Antara, from Imr al-Qais, from Tarf ibn Abd. All the other poets, they speak about war, they speak about foulness, Imr al-Qais, with women and what have you. But great language, Tarf ibn Abd speaks about environment, the greatness of camels. And he uses over 100 words to describe a camel in a poem. Every aspect of a camel, Tarf ibn Abd. And the classics, these are our classics. You know, some of us were read on Shakespeare, Sheikh Zubair, we can get the conspiracy there with Sheikh Zubair, really. We should be reading the great classics that the Sahaba also read and memorized off by heart. But which was the greatest of them? They say Ibn al-Qais is the greatest poet, but Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab says, لا أفضل على أحد صاحب من ومن ومن. I do not prefer anybody over the author of men, women, women. This is speaking of Zuhair ibn Abi Sulma, because his poetry is amazing. It's about tawheed and it's about husn al-khuluq, good character. That's all it's about. Beautiful. Tayyib. So this is, and what's the point? Why does he become Muslim, Ka'ab ibn Zuhair? Why? Because his father sees in a dream, Zuhair ibn Abi Sulma, he sees in a dream that he's ascending the heavens. He's just ascending into the heavens for him. And then he says that he sees from the heavens a ladder coming down from the heavens. And then he says he begins to ascend towards this ladder, trying to get hold of the rung. And he says just as he's about to grab the ladder, he wakes up out of the dream. And they ask him, what was the dream? He said the ladder which was being rolled down from the heavens was prophecy. And that rung which I was trying to hold on to was the last and final prophet. And the fact that I didn't get hold of it means I'm not going to meet him. I'm going to die before he manifests. This is what he said. And he says he has two sons, one called Bujair, one called Ka'ab. And he says to Bujair and Ka'ab that if you meet him, believe in him immediately. Believe him. Okay? So khalas, he dies. And then the Prophet ﷺ manifests. They live outside of Mecca. And then they hear that there's somebody who's claiming prophecy, final prophecy. Fits the descriptions. Okay, Bujair says to Ka'ab, ufbut ma'al ghanam. He says, stay with the sheep, the shepherd, stay with the sheep. I'm going to check out this because our father told us when he manifests, believe in him. He goes to Mecca, he goes to Medina, Prophet's in Medina. He gets to Medina, when he meets the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he believes in him immediately. I mean, to me, you believe in a Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, you told your brother, stay with the sheep, I'll be back. But when he gets to Medina and he believes, he doesn't go back. The experience is too profound. He remains in Medina. He just writes a letter to Ka'ab, like, get down here quickly. You see, so this is the prophet our father spoke to us about. When Ka'ab gets the letter, Ka'ab is mad. Something entered into his heart. No. Whatever it was. So Ka'ab writes a very, they write to each other in poetry. And so he writes a poem back to Bujair, and he curses Bujair, and then he also speaks bad about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He has a line, "Saqaq bihal ma'munu ka'san rawiyatan." He says this way, yani ala ubellighu anni Bujairan risalata halaka fi ma qulta laka halaka. Saqaq bihal ma'munu ka'san rawiyatan. He said, will not somebody convey to Bujair a risala, a message? Somebody tell Bujair, my brother, this message. فَهَلَّكَ فِي مَا قُلْتَ. I mean, the language is profound in Arabic. He says, هَلَّكَ, هَلَّكَ. It's like he's trying to shake sense into him. فِي مَا قُلْتَ. The words that you said, what were the words? لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدَ رَسُولُ. That were the words? Just them words? هَلَّكَ. Yani, I'm shaking sense into you regards the words that you said. هَلَّكَ. And هَلَّكَ means I'm shaking it, but in Arabic language, it also means same to him means you are destroyed. It's an amazing play upon weight. And then he says, "Saqaqa biha al-ma'mun katsan rawiyatan," that the ma'mun, that's the funny thing, the trustworthy one, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, saqaqa, he's intoxicated you, he's bewitched you, with katsan rawiyatan, with a lush drink of alcohol. I mean, you've been fooled. And when Bujair, what does Bujair do? Now, what would I do? I don't know, this is experience. Bujair, is my brother saying this to me? And he's speaking bad about the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I'm new Muslim. But Bujair goes straight to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and says, I have to read you a letter that my brother has sent. And he reads the letter to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hears the letter, when he says, Saqaka biha al-ma'munu, the Prophet stops him. And he says, Al-ma'mun wallahi. That's his word. I am the trustworthy one by God. And then he says, Man laqiya Ka'b ibn Zuhair, faqtulu. Whoever finds Ka'b ibn Zuhair, kill him. And that was, if this was, whatever you want to call it, political assassinations, a price was placed upon the head of Ka'b ibn Zuhair. His brother was the one who brought it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's what's going to happen a few years later. What happens? Fatah Mecca. Sahaba 10,000, they're going to march upon Mecca, open up Mecca. There are people who have to be killed by the edict of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Very few of them. One Ibn Akhtal, who's one who became Muslim, used to write wahi, became Muslim, and then the Prophet gave him as a teacher to other companions from a different tribe. He killed those people, and then he began to lie about the Prophet and reneged upon the religion. So the Sahaba, when they entered Mecca, they came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, Ibn al-Khattal mu'allaq bi astar al-Ka'ba. Ibn al-Khattal now is clinging on to the Kiswa, to the Ka'ba. And the Prophet said, Faqtulu, kill him. He's one of the few people who was killed. The Sahaba descended upon the Kaaba. They debate who killed him because there were that many Sahaba. When they heard the word Faqtulu, they descended upon the Kaaba to kill Ibn Khattab. For amongst them was Ka'ab ibn Zuhair. For amongst them was Ikramah ibn Abi Jahl. Ka'ab and Ikramah, clever. Because what happens? Get out of dodge. The Prophet is in Mecca. Leave, quick, fast. So they get out of Mecca. And both of them get to the Red Sea. And something which is striking, they both get to the Red Sea. As for Ikramah, we spoke about before. Wa Muhammada Ikramah. Ikramah, when he's on the boat over to the Red Sea, he's trying to cross over to Abyssinia, and his wife catches up to him at the Red Sea. She says, come, this man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he forgives those who come in repentful to him, you'll be forgiven. He said, I don't believe that. Ikramah, why? I'm the son of Abu Jahl. How much evil have I did to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How many times did I attempt to assassinate him? He's one of the leaders at Uhud with Khalid ibn Walid, who caused the killing of 70 Sahaba. How can he forgive me? He said, go and bring me proof. Me as an intelligent wife. She said, I've already gone and brought you proof. So what does she do? She just has the burda of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's on a boat, and she waves. He's gave me this. This is a sign you have saved passage. He retains, the rest is history. Ikramah. And when he meets the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does he say? I knew good would come from your father. That's his first words. I knew good would come from your father. Then he tells the Sahaba, nobody mention his father in evil. The adab and akhlaq. He's Abu Jahl. Don't speak about Abu Jahl. Because why? He has a son who's now Muslim, and it's still his father. He'd be careful of the emotions of others. What about Ka'ab? Ka'ab likewise, but in the riwayah says, the verse in the Quran, that the earth became constricted in its vastness. What do we say in English? Nowhere to run to, nowhere to hide. So likewise, he's also met at the Red Sea, and he's also told, come back, he'll give you clemency, he'll forgive you. And he doesn't want the proof. He has a greater belief, because he's been taught by a Hanif, his father, Zuhayb ibn Abi Sulaiman. So he goes back to Medina, and when he meets the Prophet in Medina, he's disguised, he's wearing his turban, and he's covered his entire face. And he says to the Prophet, who's in the masjid with Abu Bakr present and the Ansar, and he says, if Ka'ab ibn Zuhair comes to you in tawbah and repentance, will you accept his tawbah? He's pretending he's the intermediary. And the Prophet said, I accept his tawbah. He'd be forgiven clemency. And then he just strips his face and says, I am Ka'ab ibn Zuhair. I am Ka'ab ibn Zuhair. Prophet said, as if I didn't know. You see, God, we'll let it slide this time. So what happens is that at that point, he looks at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. It's amazing. He looks at Abu Bakr, Ka'ab ibn Zuhair, and he says, yeah, Abu Bakr, do you know poetry? He's a poet. That's all he does. He says, do you know poetry? And Abu Bakr says, سقاك بها المأمون كأسا رويته. Abu Bakr quotes the line where he walked, which was the reason why he was the death penalty was upon him. He quotes that line of poetry, i.e., you see, he can forgive Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but although I'm Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, it's really difficult for me to forgive. I know I have to, but I've got to work on it. That's what Abu Bakr is saying. It's difficult for me to forgive those words that you said about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Karim, who still knew, he had experienced prophecy, so he's got a bit of jahiliyyah in him. He said, you got the words wrong. You misquoted me. He said, I said, Saqaqa biha siddiq ka'san rawiyyatah. It was you, not him. He said, I don't have a problem with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam now, but I have a problem with you. Still jahil. The Ansar, when they hear him speak about Abu Bakr, the Ansar jump and they begin to unsheathe their swords. They said, Munafiq ya Rasulullah. It's man ain't Muslim. Yani, so when they jump with their swords, Ka'b turns to them, begins to hit them with poetry, cuss them out in poetry as well. He's cussing everybody out now, Ka'b. And then what happens? The Prophet ﷺ says, yeah, Ka'b, mention them bil khayr. It's the power of poetry. Speak about the Ansar with good words, not bad words. These are my people. And then when he begins to recite poetry to the Ansar, praising them, the Ansar put the swords away and they sit down and listen to Ka'b. And then when Ka'b sees this, he turns toward the Prophet Islam, and that's when he recites his famous poem, Bayanat Suad al-Qalbi Yawma Matabulu, the famous poem where the burda was wrapped over. That's Ka'b ibn Zuhair. He sort of went off, but these are important people, really important, because these are from the Hunafa, sons of the Hunafa. For amongst them is Waraq ibn Nawfal. Waraq ibn Nawfal, famous, he's the Sheikh, he's the cousin of whom? The Prophet called him a Sheikh. The Sheikh, that's what he called him, Waraq ibn Nawfal. In a beautiful hadith, he said, Ra'aytu Sheikh, I saw the Sheikh, fil Jannah, in paradise. The Prophet says, Waraq ibn Nawfal, wearing what? Thiyaban sundusin min khudar, as Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, long flowing green robes of silk in paradise. He saw them, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Shaykh Waraq ibn Nawfal. He's the cousin of Khadija, and he is, what's important about him, he is the old Shaykh, i.e. the wise one. And he was best friends with Zayd bin Amr bin Nawfal. And they went on this sojourn through Arabia to find the original religion of Ibrahim. And if God is one, God must have a religion. What is that religion? And they sojourned and they met the last Christians alive. As for Waraqa, he says, this is it. فَتَنَصَّرَ فِي الْجَاهِلِينَ حَدِّ الْبُخَارِي So he became Christian. فَكَانَ يَكْتُبْ مِنَ الْعِبْرَانِيَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَنْ يَكْتُبْ مِنَ الْحَدِيثِ He used to write in Hebrew whatever Allah Ta'ala wants a word for him to write. Fluent in Hebrew, Waraq ibn Nawfal. As for Zayd ibn Amr, he says, this is not what I'm looking for. See, I'm not looking for the last Christians. I'm looking for the first Muhammad. That's what he's looking for, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So he leaves. And when he leaves, it's a famous incident. He's on his riding beast. And then he says, he raises his hands to Allah. Says, oh Allah, I know you are one. And I know you have your religion. But I do not know how to worship you. And then he begins to prostrate on his camel as he's leaving Waraq ibn Nawfal, his great friend. Waraq ibn Nawfal becomes the first pillar the Prophet visits after Nubuwwah, after prophecy, on the advice of Khadija. Let's go and see the Shaykh. Let's see what Waraq ibn Nawfal says. Okay? Very important individual who we'll look at. The last one is Umayyah ibn Abu Salt al-Thaqafi. Umayyah ibn Abu Salt al-Thaqafi. The last one is others, but these are the great four. Umayyah ibn Abu Salt al-Thaqafi. Umayyah ibn Abu Salt al-Thaqafi. And he's a manifest great poet, writes a lot of poetry about the coming of the final prophet, describes the final prophet, but what's the mushkila with him is that when the Prophet ﷺ declares prophecy, he disbelieves in the Prophet ﷺ. You see, he died too late. Had he died a bit earlier, mashallah ta'ala, but he died after the Prophet ﷺ had manifested and he rejected belief in the Prophet ﷺ. And they actually asked him, you spoke about the coming of the final Prophet and you described his sifat, how he would be. And here is the one now declaring that what? He is what? The final prophet. Why do you not believe? He said, Kuntu arju ana akunahu. I used to have hope that it would be me. That he understood through what? The legacies of the great prophets, the final prophet would come. And he was a monotheist, but he believed that what? He had the hope that Allah would designate prophecy for him. And Allah Ta'ala knows where he places his message. And he didn't place it in what? In the tribe of Thaqif, the people of Ta'if, and Umayyah bin Abu Salt didn't place it with him. Nasallahu salam al-afiyah. The Prophet said, صَدَقَ شِعْرُهُ وَكَذَبَ قَلْبُهُ. He said that his poetry has spoken the truth, but is what his heart has denied prophecy. And to me, what's even more chilling, I think it's really chilling, because when somebody asks, why do you not believe in him? I mean, why not? This is him. It's very clear it's him. We know his history. We know what he teaches. We know what he calls to. What did he say? He says, Umayyah says, what am I going to say? And the word he uses is, he says, what am I going to say to all of them fine young ladies who I used to tell them, don't worry, it's going to be me. You see, how can I go and tell them, it's not me. It's Muhammad, the son of Abdullah al-Qurayshi al-Hashimi. You see, because it was about shuhra, it was about desire, it was about women, claiming that he was going to be the final prophet. And then it was ultimately istakbara wa kana min al-kafirin. It was about arrogance that manifested upon his limbs, that made him refuse to humble himself, like the forefather of what, of arrogance, the shaitan in love himself. Okay? Anyone have any questions? Any questions, inshallah ta'ala? Naam. Any questions? How long do we have? Okay, so the tradition we look at now, that relates to the Hunafa. You should have a clearer idea about the Hunafa. And they really do prepare society, Mecca, for the coming of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi. Okay, we look at the hadith, upon the slide of the hadith, which is a famous hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. And it's in the chapter of Imam al-Bukhari, he entitles this chapter, Kayfa Bada al-Wahi, how did revelation begin? Okay, the beginning of revelation, how did it begin? And what's going to be important is that, where does it begin? Where does revelation begin? And what does he speak about? The experience of revelation, it begins at 38 years of age. See, not revelation in and of itself, but being prepared to receive revelation. Okay? And for us, we're not being prepared to receive revelation, but we are being prepared to engage revelation. That's what the spiritual path is about, to engage it properly. As to receive it, that's khalas, it's finished. It's with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But engaging revelation is important. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the Quran has tanzeel wa tanazzul. He says, the Quran has tanzeel and tanazzul. What's tanzeel? Tanzeel is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received. Revelation. Descent. Tanzeel means the descent of the divine word. What's tanazzul? The staggered descent of the divine word that continues after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For those hearts that have been prepared. That's the hadith. Clear. And the interpretation is clear. That people still receive clarifications of the ma farratna fil kitabi min shay, the book which Allah Ta'ala has not abandoned anything in it. That's the great mufassirun, the great hearts. They receive things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew but not necessarily spoke about. Okay? Tayyib. So let's look at that, the hadith. We'll try and look at it in brief inshallah ta'ala. From the authority of Aisha, who said, two deep dreams whilst asleep were the first experience the Messenger of God had of revelation. Okay? True dreams. What's called a ru'yat al-sadiqah. The Prophet ﷺ in multiple ahadith, but the hadith al-Bukhari, it says that it's 146 of prophecy. Okay? ذَهَبَتِ النُّبُوَّةِ وَبَقِيَتِ الْمُبَشِّرَاتِ. In one riwayat al-Bukhari, prophecy is gone. All that remains are what are glad tidings. What are glad tidings? They asked the Prophet ﷺ. He said a ru'yat al-sadiqah. He said a true dream or a ru'yat al-salihah, a good dream. Because someone can have a true dream, but it may not be good. Okay? Many of us have true dreams, gazing into the real world, but they're not necessarily good. Okay? So, but both are what? Windows of prophecy. And in the other riwayat, in the Bukhari and on others, multiple narrations of it, like over seven different narrations of this, with different, percentages, fractions that relate to it. The Prophet, this one speaks of 146th of prophecy. But a true dream is 146th of prophecy. Okay, the ulama are going to say, well, why 146th? They choose this, like let's say Ibn Abi Jamrah. And they say that this is because the Prophet, وسلم, as we alluded to in the beginning, his mission is 23 years from engaging Gabriel. You see, with revelation, 23 years. And they, as the hadith is going to tell us, that the Prophet وسلم, experiences true dreams, which are really called, what we'd call premonitions. As Aisha describes, Aisha is describing a premonition. يَأْتِكَ فَلَقَ الصُّبْحِ. She says, when he sees it in the dream state, the next day, like the splitting of the dawn, it happens. It's a premonition, okay? For 6 months, okay? So the ulama say, why is it 146 the prophecy? Because as in the hadith, this is the first engagement of revelation for 6 months. If we put 6 over 23 years, we get 146. That's how they explain it. It's 146 the prophecy, how revelation was in the form of dreams prior to Gabriel. And what is important about this, because it prepares the Prophet ﷺ for what is about to take place. It's preparation. Because Gabriel, as we're going to see what happens with the Prophet ﷺ, it's, as we would say, it's no joke to experience Gabriel. That you have to be prepared to meet Gabriel. And that Allah Ta'ala is going to prepare the Prophet ﷺ through the dream state. Like you can prepare many people thereafter. You see something, you say, where have I seen that before? Deja vu. You see, if it's good deja vu, Allah Ta'ala is preparing you for something. Like with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من رآني في المنام فقد رآني فإن الشيطان لا يمثلني. And the one who sees me in the dreams, they've seen me because the devil can't take my form. What's all that about? من رآني في المنام فقد سيراني يقظة. The one who sees me in the dream state will see me in the wake state. Preparation. Seeing in the dream prepares to see, want to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the wake state in this dunya. You're not asleep, dreaming, but the eyes are gazing upon him as if he's high, as if he's alive in his dunyawi form. Okay? And what does that prepare you for? مَنْ رَآنِي فِي الْمَنَامِ سَيَرَىٰ الْحَقِّ. The last hadith Imam al-Tirmidhi brings, that whoever sees you in the dream state will see the real. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Preparations. And that's what the dream state is a very important world. And when we lose touch with that world, we have lost touch with ourselves. Because it's very important. It's one of the ultimate ways, windows we get into the other world. One of the ultimate windows we get into what? The world that comes after death. The Akhirah, the Qiyamah, Jannah, Wanar. A great window that we get. But the only way you access that window is through tazkiyah, purity of the heart. So it's the heart, it's the eye of the heart, it's the soul that experiences the real. Okay, so the two dreams whilst asleep with the first experience of the Messenger of God, the had of revelation, Aisha says, never did he dream but that it would happen just like the breaking of the dawn. Then seclusion was made beloved to him. Okay, and the ulama say that then it's not necessarily comes after it, because this is the two dreams are during what this formative period, they don't cease and they become more intense as his 40th birthday approaches. So what next? Seclusion. Hubbiba ilayhi al-khalwa. So the Prophet ﷺ now began to remove himself from society, began to leave society, became a recluse. And that seclusion of the Prophet ﷺ is going to take place for a long period of time. Most of the ulama that have it, approximately 7 years, the Prophet ﷺ is going to stay in a state of seclusion. Okay? 7 years, from 38 to 45 years of age. Okay? And that is what's going to be very important in the formative years of the Prophet ﷺ's prophecy. Because he's carrying what nobody else is carrying, has ever carried, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What becomes important sign of that is, well, who engages society? If you're hitting the hills, who's engaging society? Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. That's why all the great initial Muslims who become Muslim through da'wah, they come at the hands of Abu Bakr, not the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In fact, the first khatib, the first one to speak in the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah is Abu Bakr, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in the audience. See, Abu Bakr has connections with society. Abu Bakr is what we call now a socialite. He's a man who's amongst people. He's not a recluse. The Prophet ﷺ is the opposite. Somebody who's hit the hills, yatahannath. Sayyidina Hum, Aisha uses a very important word. He used to exclude himself in Hira, the great cave of Hira, where his forefathers used to go, where Abu Muttalib hit with Hashim, and the others would hit the great cave there in that great mountain. He would go and worship there. What was amazing about Hira? Two things about Hira, they said what was amazing about Hira. One, it's big enough to worship in. See, it's not too big, not too small. It's just the right size for somebody who wants to be secluded in there and to worship. First quality of Hira. What's the second quality of Hira? That from Hira, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you'd sit in Hira, you'd gaze right at the Kaaba. You could see the Kaaba with your naked eyes. So that's what's important about that cave Hira, where the Prophet chose Hira over other different caves. What did he used to do in Hira? Well, Aisha uses the word yatahanna, which here henna it's difficult. What's one of its words? Hinth in the Arabic language means to it means impurity, something which is impure. And yatahannath, it means in the Arabic language, and we look at the form in Arabic, tafa'ala, which is the form tafa'ala, it has several meanings. Of its meaning is tajannab. Tajannab. Okay, so I tahannuth is tajannubul hinth. First meaning. What does this mean? And that's why I translated it here. Shedding impurities. It is to cast impurities aside. Okay? To cleanse the heart. To purify the self. That's the word Aisha uses. He spends 2 years in Hira. Yatahanna. Then the Rawi says, yata'abbad. That they mean by tahanna, ta'abbad. Worship. He's worshipping Allah. But how is he worshipping Allah, Jalla fil ula? The ulama say that it's through قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Purification. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابُ وَالْحِكْمَةِ يعني يَتْلُ عَلَيْهُمُ الْكِتَابُ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. Allah Ta'ala says that he recites the book to them and he purifies them, يُزَكِّيهِمْ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in the Quran. So here the Prophet is undergoing the shedding of impurities, not because he's impure صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he's showing us manhaj. That's how you approach it. That he's showing us how we experience prophecy. He shows us how to become people of purity. And one of the things that you can know about people of purity is that if they do not remove themselves from society, they can never become pure. You see, it's essential on the spiritual path for you to reject society and leave society. And that's why when the Prophet, yani the Sahaba, become Muslim in the formative period, not only does he hit the hills, but he tells the Sahaba, go and find yourself some caves. You all need to get out of Dodge. You need to go through this period of what, of purification, such that you are now cleansed and able to face society in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees. Another great meaning of hinth, hinth in azim is Surah Al-Waqi'ah. What does hinth in Surah Al-Waqi'ah mean? Covenants, oaths, contracts. And if the taking of contracts here, tafa'ala, would mean bitadarruj, in degrees. It's taking contract after contract after contract, smaller to a bit bigger to a bit bigger, to you're able to what? To take the big covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which comes in the form of a Namus al-Akbar, the holder of the heavenly secret, Gabriel in and of himself. Okay, this is tahanna, very important. That's what he's doing in that. She says here, which is to worship for nights on end without returning back to his family. He would leave his family. Khadija, Fatima, Zahra, al-Buthul, Zainab, Kulthum. He would leave his family in Mecca and he would just remain there. What would he return back for? Sometimes he would return back to his house to give his family his right, to take his provision once again, stock of provision, food, etc. Then he would hit Hira once again. What would he do in Hira? One of the most amazing things about the Prophet in Hira, why has he taken food? Why has he taken food? To show us that if we're going to hit the hills, you better take the means as well. Don't think you're the greatest spiritual master of your age. Don't worry, Allah will feed me. Allah will make you die of hunger because you ain't been prepared for it. So the Prophet ﷺ is showing us how do we go into a state of seclusion. Like one of us go to i'tikaf, what it's like, one of the ways that we've been going to seclusion in the month of Ramadan. So here, what does the Prophet ﷺ do, which is amazing, and we don't follow him in this, is that when he hits Hira, he sits on Hira. When he was in Mecca, he used to take care of the poor, the disadvantaged. You'll see in the statement of Khadija. You see, when he hits the hills Hira, the poor have got to come for their stipend from the Prophet ﷺ. They follow him to the mountains. And he's all that provision he's took from Khadija, he gives it out. Gives it out. You see, abit and the Rabbi. He said, I stay with my Lord, yut'imini wa yusqini. He feeds me, he drinks me, the Prophet ﷺ would say. That's the Messenger ﷺ. Sometimes he wouldn't even come to his family. That great pillar Khadija would meet him halfway. It was like as if it was, it's like intuition that she would ascend and he would descend and they would meet halfway on the mount of the Hira and they would just exchange provision and he would hit the hills once again, radiallahu ta'ala, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa radiallahu ta'ala anha. He would make the necessary preparations for this, thereafter returning back to Khadija and immediately making the necessary preparations for the life. He just come and go for 2 entire years. This continued until the real came unto him. Now that is Hattara al-Haq. That's the words of whom? Of Aisha al-Bukhari. Until the real. Haq is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Until the real came unto him. And this is going to be the not necessarily the beginning, but in our sense, one of the first beginnings of the Prophet experiencing the real Allah in the dream state. You can see multiple ahadith in Musnad of Ahmed of others, later the Prophet experiencing Allah through the dream state. And the great exception to the experience of Allah is the Isra al-Mi'raj, where he experiences it in yaqabatan, in the wake state. Okay, but here he experiences Allah in hatta ra' al-haq. Ru'ya is a dream. That's what Aisha is saying. Came unto him whilst he was in Hira cave. Such that, what follows on from that, the angel came unto him and said, Iqra. Okay? That's what the angel said, Iqra. Okay? First thing we have to cast aside is imposing our worldview upon what other civilizations, as the West is just wanting to do. You try and see everybody through their own eyes and based upon their own criterion. And we fall guilty to that. So the first thing we know that Iqra does not mean read. That's the first thing. Okay? Prophet ﷺ is Nabi al-Ummi. Huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasula. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran. He's the one who sent amongst oral people. People who did not read or write. Nahnu ummatun ummiya. And the Prophet said in al-Bukhari, we are an oral nation. We do not write and we do not use numbers. That's not us. So the Prophet ﷺ, by Gabriel, is not being instructed to read. Because after the fact, he still cannot read. So what is the word? Iqra has a few things. It has a few meanings. Read is one of its last significations. The first signification of Iqra is to gather. One of its means, gather. To gather something. You see, and what the Prophet says, in that sense of being instructed, is the gathering of revelation. That is why to read, they use the word Iqra, the Arabs, because it gathers meanings in words. The word Iqra in the Arabic language, it means to gather, it's asl, that's what it means. Of its other meanings, Iqra is also to recite. And that's why the Qur'an is a recital. If you wanted to translate the Qur'an, if, some say it's impermissible, some say it's permissible, what would the Qur'an be in English? The recital, that which is recited. Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. It is upon us in Surah Al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, to gather and to recite it. That's what he says, Allah Ta'ala. With Quran, and the Quran is used to recite Surah Al-Qiyamah. So, Iqra, recite the oral prophet. That sound. Gather, oral prophet, that sound also. Iqra, also, it refers to something which is a lot more metaphysical, which relates to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam moving through the spheres of existence. Because what is happening with Gabriel is not that Gabriel is experiencing the Prophet wasallam, but the Prophet wasallam is experiencing Gabriel. That's what Ibn Khaldun in his Muqaddimah says, that the Prophet wasallam now has to strip himself of his Bashariya, of his humanness, his human nature. He has to come out of his human form into angelic form, into the world of souls to experience Gabriel. That's what you're about to hear being described in the language of Aisha, which comes forth from the Prophet ﷺ. So what does Iqra mean? Iqra means that you have to knock, move beyond the first realm. Literally means to knock. What's that realm? The mulk, the world of the dominion, the physical world. What's the second time? Iqra, a second time. Move beyond the second realm. What is that? Malakut, the world of angels. You've got to move beyond this. This is revelation from Allah Ta'ala. What is the third? The third is what? Is Iqra, Jabarut, the world of the Hamalat al-Arsh. Move beyond that world. Hatta ra' al-haq. Until you experience the true Allah Ta'ala. Read Ibn Abi Jamrah, Shahr al-Bukhari. He will tell us about this, the experience the Prophet has to go through just to experience revelation. I mean, revelation ain't no joke. What do you think Gabriel comes with? Like a few words to dictate them to you. You think that's what it's all about? That's why if you read the accounts of the Prophet in Revelation, Ashad alayh, Salsalat al-Jaras, he would say, the ringing of bells. The Sahaba, when they see the Prophet experience revelation, they would take off their cloaks and cover him. Cover, khalas, leave him. He would be in convulsions. What's taking place? It's the most difficult experience. Hatta balaghani al-jahad, he says in the Hadith al-Bukhari, till I reach the point of no return, I'm about to die. My soul's about to leave my body because it has to get to that point in order to experience the angel. Difficult for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's like Isa in the Quran. Why does Allah Ta'ala say about Jesus, tawaffa, that we were? Jesus, we made him, he used the word wafa, die. Is Jesus dead? Meaning you could prove in the Quran that Jesus died. If you're going to take the word literally, it doesn't mean that. What does it mean to offer? That his soul, he has to undergo what the Prophet underwent in order to ascend into the world of the Malakut, the unseen realm, the unseen dominion of Allah Ta'ala. بِيَدِ مَلَكُوتْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. As Allah said in the end of Surah Al-Yasin, in his hands lies the Malakut, the unseen realm of everything, جَلَّ فِي الْعُلَىٰ. And see, this is the difficulty. What shall I recite? مَنَا بِقَارِي. No, yani, not how you see it translated. I cannot read. That's erroneous. That is the Western literal mind and those who have been affected by it imposing itself upon what the revelation. What shall I recite? It can mean that. That's the trickiness. Ma ana biqari. So ma, is it negation? Yani, I cannot read. Or is it what you call istifham, interrogative, asking a question? What shall I recite? That's how it's best interpreted. What shall I recite? What does Gabriel do? Fadammahu. Okay, he said he took hold of me and squeezed me until I reached the point of no return. فَأَرْسَلَنِ. And he used the same word for risala. He lets me go. Then he says, اقرأ. Gabriel once again recite. The Prophet ﷺ, what shall I recite? So he took hold of me a second time and squeezed me a second time until I reached the point of no return, what we described before. Then he released me. He then said, recite. I replied, what shall I recite? So he took hold of me and squeezed me a third time. Then he released me. And then he said, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Because that's where your experience is now. Recite in the name of your Lord who created. So this is the Prophet ﷺ now engaging the first revelation. Created man from a zygote, min alaq. Recite, and your Lord is most generous, the one who taught by the pen, the primordial pen, which all knowledge in the creation is inscribed by virtue of al-qalam. أَوَلُ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْقَلَمُ. In a riwayat, the first thing Allah Ta'ala created was that primordial pen by which he taught man what he was ignorant of. Aisha quotes it. So he immediately returned back to her. After this, he goes back to who's here? Khadija. And who's the first person? As we made mention, that Khadij in the Arabic language, the missing rib. She completes the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who's already complete. That she's the missing rib in the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That is all the half. I mean, it's amazing just that the story, that what we can call the love story between the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the great perfect woman called Khadija, who Allah sends salams to. Imagine Allah said, go and give Khadija salams for me. So he entered upon Khadija, the daughter of Khuwaylid, and thereby saying, Zemmiluni, Zemmiluni. It wasn't in convulsions. Cover me, cover me. So she covered him until the trepidation had subsided. What's the fear? It's the experience now of Allah and of the Archangel Gabriel, revelation. So he said to Khadija, indeed I was overcome with fear for myself. What does this mean? What we described, he reached the point of no return. This is the first time the Prophet is undergoing this type of experience. First time, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So Khadija replied, nay. See, this is if you got into the idea of spirituality, you look at the great imams of this ummah, and an example is like Imam Nawawi radiallahu ta'ala, who dies at 44 years of age. What's the clinical reason, the ulama say, for the death of Nawawi, the great Nawawi? 40 hadith of Nawawi, Riyadh al-Salihin of Nawawi, the great imam of the ummah, great Shafi'i imam. What would be on the death certificate of Nawawi? Spiritual experience. That's what they say why he died, Imam Nawawi, at 40, at such a young age. That when the great descent came upon Imam Nawawi, it took his life. That's what the Prophet is telling us about. Read the account of one of the great imams, Imam Abdul Wahhab al-Sha'rani. You know, Abdul Wahhab al-Sha'rani, he would tell his students, you see, you know, he's the great Imam of Ashar al-Sha'rani in the 10th century time of Suyuti. He tells his students, you see, don't follow me. I command you to pray in the mosque. Don't take me as an example. He said, why? He said, because a lot of times you don't find me in the mosque at Fajr. He said, because I'm not like you. He said, why? Yeah. He says, because a lot of times, because of the spiritual descent, I cannot move. I can't move. He said, a lot of times, Abdul Wahhab al-Sha'rani, they would find him knocked out in the middle of the street between the mosque and his house at Fajr time. He's trying to get to the mosque, and he couldn't. obviously for many of us, it may be fairy tales, but this is the reality of those who really engage in religion as it was meant to engage. And you'll see this with the companions themselves. Okay? So Khadija, what does she say? She says, no. She says, God would never humiliate you. La yukhziyak Allah. God would never abase you, ever. Indeed, you maintain bonds. Here she speaks about the great makarim. The greatest proofs of who he is his character. You maintain bonds of kinship with those who break them. You carry the burden of the weak. You reap unimaginable gain. Some say, what you call, tuksib al-ma'adun. Really powerful language. I translate it as unimaginable gain. And even when you engage in trade for me, you would get money where there was no money. Where did that come from? That's one meaning. But the other meaning, tuksib al-ma'adun, which is more powerful, and maybe I should change it, because they have both meanings, the difficulty of the language. Tuksib al-ma'adun means that you sustain through your wealth the ma'adun. Who the ma'adun? Yani those who are worthless in society. The homeless, those who are abandoned, those who nobody knows their names, as the Prophet ﷺ says, when they died, nobody knew who they were. Their names were not remembered in the hadith of Ahmed. Nobody prayed over them. Nobody, like you did the famous hadith of the black Abyssinian woman, that when she just sweep the mosque, nobody knew her name. Person comes back from a journey, says, where is she? He said, who? He said, the woman. He said, she died, Ya Rasulullah, we buried her. He said, you buried her without telling me. The Prophet went straight to the grave of that woman. These are the awliya. And he, khalas, they're not mentioned. Their names are not mentioned. They're unknown. That's why Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he says, al-dhuhur niqmatun wa kullu nas yatamannahu. Wal-khumul ni'matun wa kullu nas yabahu. Tuba liman akhmal Allahu dhikrahu. He says, manifestation to be known is a punishment human beings desire. Ahmad ibn Hanbal says, he says, to be hidden is a blessing people are averse to. And then he said, glad tidings to the one who Allah makes his remembrance hidden. That's the nature of the great people. So that's those who reap unimaginable gain, or you what? Or you always sustain and help those who nobody knows about in society. And what's important about this is that we'll see the later hadith of Ibn Dughanna, that when Abu Bakr is cast out of Mecca later, and what I really want to stress is what Abu Bakr, when he's cast out of Mecca, and they asked Abu Bakr's at the Red Sea, and he meets a chief of a tribe, Ibn Dughanna, and he says, Abu Bakr, where are you going? And he said, my people have cast me out of Mecca. He's forced to leave Mecca after prophecy. And he says, what are you going to do? He says, I am going to wander earth worshipping Allah. That's what he says, Abu Bakr. I'm just going to wander the earth just worshipping Allah Ta'ala. That's an aesthetic by definition. And Ibn Dughanna says, no. You're going back to Mecca, and I'm going to be your protector. Why, Abu Bakr? What does he say? He quotes the exact same things here. It's hadith in Sahih Bukhari, both of them in Bukhari. He quotes the same hadith. Why? You have a right to live in that land because you maintain bonds of kinship. You carry the burden of the weak. You reap unimaginable gain, or you help those who are worthless in society, and you treat guests well, and you assist in times of truth. He quotes the exact same characteristics, which shows you how the Prophet ﷺ imprints upon his companions. See, that's tiba'. That's adherence to the way of the Prophet ﷺ. We're going to close up here. So Khadija took him to Waraqah ibn Nawfal, ibn Asad, the great Halif, Abi ibn Abdul Uzza. Okay? Remember, Khadija is Khadija bin Khuwaylid ibn Asad. Okay? So that's how she's a cousin to whom? To Waraqah ibn Nawfal. The paternal cousin of Khadija, who was an individual who had turned to Christianity in the period of ignorance. It's Aisha's words. He was able to write the Bible, writing from the gospel, whatever God willed for him to write, fluent. He was a very old man who had now gone blind, called Umi. He was blind. So Khadija said to him, oh cousin, listen to your nephew. I listened to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's not literally his nephew, but obviously because they're Qurayshis, she speaks with a term of endearment. He listened to him. So Waraqah said to him, oh nephew, what is it that you have seen? What have you experienced? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed him exactly what he had witnessed, and thus did Waraqah say to him, this is the supreme holder of the heavenly secret. What he calls a Namus al-Akbar, Gabriel. But the word he uses is the supreme holder of the heavenly secret. That's Gabriel, who we can speak about later in the interest of time. Who God exalted be, he sent down to Moses. Sent to Moses. The ulama say, why didn't he say Jesus? He's a Christian, Waraqah ibn Nawfal. He took Christianity at the hands of the last true Christians. Why didn't he say Jesus? They said because he's speaking about Gabriel. And Gabriel's descent upon Moses was worth greater than his descent upon Jesus. Jesus' mission is less than 4 years. Moses' mission is a lot longer. There's no other prophet, they say, who engages Gabriel more than Moses, with the exception of the prophet. Moses is in second place. The prophet engages Gabriel 124,000 times. He engages Gabriel in his period of his life. So that's why he says Moses and not Jesus whilst he was a Christian. Would that I had the virility of youth. Would I be still young? Would that I live to see the day when your people cast you out? He says to the Prophet, who's shocked by this, how mukhrijiyahum, they throw me out. Mecca, la uqsimu bihadha al-balad, anta hillun bihadha al-balad. Me, Mecca, Qurayshi, Hashimi, out of Mecca. What does Warqa said? He says, yes. Never has a man came with the like of what you have brought, save that he was opposed out of enmity, out of spite. You know, bid'an min al-rusul, as Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran. It's not new that you're going to undergo. The other prophets have faced the same. From amongst that, they've been cast out. Was not Moses cast out of Egypt? Was not Ibrahim cast out of Babylon? You can go, was not Nuh cast out? Was not Lut cast out? Was not Saleh cast out? Was not Hud cast out? You can see all of the prophets. They don't die in the places that they were sent, ordinarily. That's the beauty of the Prophet. I mean, Saint Musa alayhi salam is not even inside the promised land. He's on the border of the part in Kathib al-Ahmar. Doesn't even die inside the promised land. But the power of our Prophet, he dies inside of the promised land, Medina to Munawwara. The Prophet. Tayyib. And then he said, if I live to see that day of yours, then I will aid and abet you. That's tantamount to his belief. He's met the Prophet and he believes in the Prophet. If I live to see the day when this happens, I'll be there. This is a blind old man. Say, I'm going to give you victory. If it comes to that, and it will come to that. And it did come to that. And the Prophet saw the words of Waraka ibn Nawfal. Manifest Waraka died soon after. But he was one, his Islam is confirmed. And you see even in the case of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala Sayyidina Bilal, when he saw Sayyidina Bilal being tortured in Mecca, Waraka would approach Bilal and he would say to Bilal, Uthbut, Uthbut. And Bilal saying, Ahad, Ahad, one God, one God. He'd say, be firm. And Waraka would say, by God, that if you die under this torture, I will take the place of your death as a place of worship. That's what he said. Yeah, make it a maqam, the way. That's what Ibn Nawfal used about Bilal. And also, Bilal doesn't die under that type of torture. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises him in degrees. So inshallah, we'll finish there. Inshallah, I think in the next class we have to carry on because, inshallah ta'ala, this is, I think, one of the most important classes because it relates to prophecy in and of itself, which is the foundation of everything that's about to come. Okay, inshallah ta'ala. So, okay. I mean, recently I had a conversation with some Christians who said, how can Muslims say that Jesus was Ruhullah? That is as good as saying it is God himself. Well, no. Because then it's as good as saying that Adam is God himself. Because Allah Ta'ala in the Quran says, وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِ. I instilled in Adam my spirit, my soul. That's what Allah says in the Quran about saying Adam alayhi salam. So if we're going to say that on the basis of this, that Jesus is God, then likewise saying Adam is God. Okay, and then we would carry on. Likewise, every other human being is also God. And we also had what? We've had deviant movements that believe by virtue of the soul, all human beings are God. They've existed inside the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. They've existed. Okay, so no, because what does ruh mean? It means a soul that is dear to God, not God's soul. Ruhi means my soul, the same as the Kaaba is my house, the same as what? Naqati, the camel of Salih is my, same as Rusuli, my messengers. Do you understand? It's for what you call Tashrif. Just Allah ennobling the great thing that what connects to him, but it's not him. And it's very clear. As they objected to the word of Allah, what is the best response to them in question to these topics? Yani, that's it. Yani, the word of Allah, kun faya kun, that's why it's the word of Allah. And Allah cast it through his kunniyah. Can also claim she is a hanif, that she accepts the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but she isn't a Muslim, but a monotheist. My question is, even after the message from our Prophet, can people still... No, people can't be hunafa. Okay, the hunafa are gone, yani. The hunafa, you cannot claim to be a hanif, a monotheist, and reject the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Karen Armstrong, that she accepts the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but she isn't a Muslim, is a contradiction of terms. Because to be a Muslim is tawheed and it's acceptance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's it. That's the asal of the shahada. So she accepts both. If she's a monotheist and she believes in the Prophet, she's a Muslim, full stop. But for here to claim that she's a Hanif, no. Okay? No, that's not going to be acceptable. Okay? Not going to be acceptable. So, Allah Ta'ala alam. Okay? Tell you, what do you say when doing wudu in a toilet? As far as I know, you can't say Bismillah in a toilet without it, because your wudu is definitely accepted, but it's having bad adab to mention Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala's name inside. And the fuqaha debate about whether it's haram or makruh, some even render it jawaz, depending on whether, what does in the toilet mean? That's what they'll ask, what is in the toilet? Ordinarily, what they mean by the toilet is what? Is the actual place. So the fuqaha all agree upon the place where you answer the call to nature. Because what we've, again, don't impose our world upon their world. The Prophet ﷺ never had toilets, Sahaba never had toilets. There was no toilets in houses, no toilets in mosques, no toilets in buildings. Where were toilets? The outback. You go into the outback, and it's the place where you sat is your toilet. So you mean there's no door to open, no door to close? Always try and remember this, based on the context of prophecy. Okay, so the fuqaha would debate with regard to this. Adab, we have places that have been designated toilets. Adab, don't mention Allah Ta'ala's name or take anything with Allah Ta'ala's name inside of such places. Did the Prophet receive anything from Wahi, Ilham, before 38 years? I hear someone that the Prophet prophetic Wahi commenced on the day of his birth. I think Sayyid Alusi mentioned in his Tafsir Ruh al-Ma'ani. Is there anything that in the statement of his scholars back this view? Jazakallah khair. Scholars don't back your view. They don't back your view. Revelation of the Prophet begins with Gabriel at 40 years of age. Going back to the view of Imam al-Rusi in Ruh al-Ma'ani, which is one of the great tafsir, the great Iraqi Shaykh, but they're not going to back that. Okay, so on, return back to what al-Rusi says, what most likely what you're going to see with al-Rusi, Allah Ta'ala alam, but al-Rusi, one of the great Imams of the Ummah, he's referring to Qadqir, something that people have said, but it's not something that the religion claims to be the fact. The Prophet does not receive, he's not receiving revelation at what, from his birth. But revelation commences upon Ala Ratsi Arba'ina Sana, as Sayyidina Anas says in Bukhari, on his 40th birthday. If a scholar who was studied from the Ahl Sunnah, but his teachings that aren't concorded with the teaching of Ahl Sunnah and renders traditional practice as bid'ah and shirk, and in doing so accused the Sahaba, Tabi'een, and Salaf as Mubtadi' and Mushrik, I'm sure he didn't say that, but that's someone's inference. I know the term bid'ah is used very loosely today. What is the view of the scholars of such a person to pray and seek guidance and teaching from them? It's complex because I think it alludes to he's saying that the companions are mushrikeen, etc. I'm sure he's not saying that. But what he's alluding to are practices, possibly my interpretation of this, are practices that people do, Ahl Sunnah do, that he's ignorant of the fact that the Sahaba did. So when he calls Ahl Sunnah mushriks or mubtadi'un for them practices, one could infer from that, possibly, that he's also accusing the Sahaba of also being mushriks or tabi'een of mushriks. That type of person is a person who's in need of adab and deep discipline. Okay, and one shouldn't sit at the feet of such an individual. Simple as that. The Prophet ﷺ, he says to Abdullah ibn Umar, Dinaka, Dinaka, be careful of your religion. What they call Mansub al al-Hadar. Be careful of your religion, be careful of your religion. Khudh min al-ladhina istaqamu. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, take it from those who are upright upon religion. They're known, their teachers are known, their understandings of the religion are known. You see, alhamdulillah, always remember this, taraktukum ala mahajjat al-bayda. I've left you on a clear path. Layluha ka naharuha, it's light, it's like it's day. La yazigu anha illa halak, you don't stray from it, it's destroyed. I mean, what does that mean? We have, mashallah ta'ala, 1400 years of mashallah scholarship. You see, meaning anything you want to know about the religion, cast it in the light of 1400 years of Islamic scholarship. Easy. Don't think it's difficult to discern the religion. Sahih al-Bukhari, ad-deen, yus. The religion is simple. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's not complex, it's not gloomy, it's not difficult. When does it become difficult? When you see the sun shining, and we just put this over our heads, and we say it's dark in here. That's when it becomes problematic and difficult. Okay, so we block off the 1400 years. We block off the ulama of this time. Those who have chain of transmission all the way back. We block off every single Islamic institution that has taught the same religion. Trace in, what did Azhar teach for the last 900 years? What did Qarawiyyin teach for the last 1,000 years? What did Zaytun teach for the last 800, 700 years? And what did all of these, Nizamiya, every institution we have ever built, that has ever been known, taught one type of Islam? What's the problem? I'm confused. I really am confused. Sorry. As-salamu alaykum. When the Prophet ﷺ said he had knowledge of the time when Nuh was in the ark of Adam, in the garden of earth, what are we meant to take from the Prophet ﷺ's new knowledge? That the Prophet ﷺ was what? That he was aware. of things in the world of soul. That's what we take from this. The Prophet ﷺ's form is crafted in what? Inside of the womb of his mother, Amina. That's where his form is. That's where his soul, no? The Prophet ﷺ's, everybody, this is that belief, theology, aqidah, so any book in aqidah, souls are created before the physical form. Souls exist before the physical form. That's our belief in any book of aqidah. So the Prophet ﷺ's soul exists prior to his physical form. His physical form is crafted in the womb of his mother, and we studied that. As for his soul, it has an existence. And as Al-Ghazali in his book, which is called The Wonder of the Heart, the Wonder of Souls, he speaks about our knowledge, our emotions, our spiritual experience is all the property of the soul. It's got nothing to do with the body. In fact, the body only becomes veils for the true manifestation of the soul. So what he's speaking about is his experience in the world of soul, in soul form. That's what he's speaking about very, very clear, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And hadith are too numerous in that regard, which refer to his experience, Quran as well as ahadith. Now,
can you give the Holy Quran that is translated into English, can you give it to somebody who's not a Muslim to read?
The Quran is Arabic, full stop. So if you give a translation of the Quran, quote unquote translation of the Quran, in English without any Arabic, yes, because that's not Quran. Okay, what you cannot give to a non-Muslim is the Arabic, and be careful of that. There are 25 ahadith where the Prophet ﷺ rendered it impermissible for us to live in this land. Scary ahadith from them is even if you are born in that land and you pray, your prayer will never be accepted until you leave it. What do they say it all returns back to? The Quran. It's striking and frightening. The Quran in its Arabic form falling into the hands of disbelievers. You see, we've lost that type of sort of esteem for the Quran. So to answer your question, if it's purely English, then give it to whomever you like. Okay? But if it's Arabic in it, no. Refrain. No. Any further questions?
Can you just shed, you mentioned about like 99% of the people going...
Well, the hadith is clear. And the hadith says that basically 1% will enter into paradise.
Is that like of all time?
It's not necessarily of all time. You see, because there is times where there's dominance of belief. But it's if we average it all out, that's how it's going to look. I mean, and it's in hellfire. Allah speaks about hellfire. It's vaster than the heavens. It's vaster than the heavens in the air. That Allah Ta'ala strikes a striking example in Surah Al-Kahf, as well as Sahih Al-Bukhari, which speaks about hellfire. The hellfire is vast. Very, very vast. Okay? And the spaciousness of paradise is part of it, is that what? There's not that many people in there, relatively to those who are in hell. And hellfire is only so vast, expands with its inhabitants, and it's only satisfied in the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, where like in the Quran, it says, Halim talati. Allah asks the hellfire, are you full? And what does hellfire respond? Hal min mazid. Surah al-Kahf in the Quran, is there any more? In Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ says, that hellfire does not become satisfied until Allah, this hadith literally, places qadam, his foot, inside of hell. Which doesn't mean Allah has feet, but it means tajalli. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests satisfaction to hellfire, and that's enough. Subjugates hellfire. If you know you put your foot on somebody's neck, like Abu Dharr al-Ghifari told Bilal, place your foot on my neck. Okay? To subjugate, to humiliate, like Allah subjugates a base hellfire, that's it. Inhabitants are complete. Okay? So that's it. Nasallahu salaam wa al-afiyah. And that's why our muhimma, our role in life is first and foremost ourselves. To make sure we're not one of them. And that is, it's a selfish motive. Allah Ta'ala in the Quran says, Qoo anfusakum, save yourselves. That's how he says. Wa ahleekum. And those, your families, from a fire whose fuel is men and stones. So save ourselves, and then begin to save those who we can save. And don't think it's easy. It's something that's difficult. Tayyip.